All right, what's up?
You're welcome to the Black Box on Bounce Radio. How are you doing?
I'm doing great.
Good to see you.
Very, very good, actually.
Thanks for being here, man.
Thank you very much, boss.
Let me start with congratulations on the new house. Why did you feel the need to post it?
I have several houses, but this one, I like it.
It's fine, Sha.
Yes, it is fine. I like it more. And then I already saw some people perambulating my house already that figured out that it was my house before I posted it. And at the end of the day, they will not just go and put out one story like I don't want them to help me and go and put story out the way I don't want the story to be. So, as I saw them perambulating in the morning, because I've been there.
And you've moved in there already?
Yes, I've been staying there for about 1 to 2 months now.
Okay.
Yeah, but as I saw those people perambulating with camera in the morning, in the night, I've not seen any news. I just said, let me just go post my house there because they'll come and talk one long story, and I don't want to Allah. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, but it's a thing of joy.
Yeah,
I'm happy. I like it. It's beautiful. My parents are happy. They like it. I have other houses that are out for rent or on the mainland and stuff like that. Yeah, but this one is like sort of a family home.
Did you ever hear stories that you were living in a rented house, that you didn't own your house?
Yes. It's not stories. It's not something that you hide.
Yeah.
I'm not one of those people that I'm big on you can't use house to bugger me. I have a lot of things that I'm going to do with 300, 400 million lying around than to just throw it on top of a house. Business-wise, I actually prefer to invest it on my businesses. I have a couple of businesses that money is going to do me well than to just be looking at a big giant house. So I'm not one of those people that I care too tough about, do you have a house or you don't have a house? I moved from a renter. That is the video that I did for A Wave, Ira Stars, one of those kits that I did that I was carrying a box on my head.
Yes, I remember.
I was actually living in the rented house. I was carrying the box. I was like, okay, can you just take me a video from that, from the door? And I took it and I just went out. I dropped the video. This is so, I don't really care. I'm not living in your house. I moved from different places to different places. The guy could do me from this one. I can move to somewhere else. The money is my money. It's not going anywhere.
So you didn't feel, because the perception people had was, oh,
that what I'm broke.
Money no day again. They rent house, they hold on, just never feel buy a house. Did you ever hear that? And so it never bothered you?
Nah, man, come on. I don't understand. Like you get to a point in your life where come on, the people that did, trust me, the people that even arguing the argument, like, it doesn't really, so what? Okay, so I'm broke.
Exactly, so what?
Okay, so what? Like, come on, you need to feed me now, I don't beg you for food. Like, it don't matter. The people we know, the people that matter, and know what's up, they know what's up, but if you don't need to know what's up, all right, leave it.
Fair enough, man. Good to know that. Congratulations again. You say you have a lot of houses. Do you have an idea how many? Rough.
About 5.
In Lagos?
Yes.
Okay. So they're all like rented out or?
Yes.
So is that a conscious business effort or it just happened that you just kept buying without?
It is what I intend to. There are two things that I'm going to do at the end of the day. VC and real estate.
Okay.
Yes. I'm just going to be investing. I like investing in people's businesses. I do already, but then I'll do that in larger scale at some point. And real estate. After I finish this music thing, when you acquire all the whole money that you feel like you want to acquire, at the end of the day, that's the goal.
Yeah.
Grow the amount of estates that you have Or maybe cryptocurrency now. if our government they allow us.
That one is a whole other conversation. Yes. So this house you just got, how many rooms are there?
It's just 5.
And you live alone?
Yeah. I'm a bachelor, making
money. In 5 rooms?
Exactly. That's the same thing. That's the thing that I said, I saw somebody just come in and said that it's not big Don Jazzy, it's not Don Jazzy, Don Jazzy. Why are you people not doing it as if this house is very small? They say it's very small. And I said, come on, I don't even move away from my room. Like, it's already too big, so what am I going to use it for? Like, it's nothing. What do you want to use it for? Like, it's Nigeria that gives us this mentality
that you must own this.
You must own a house, you must own this one. Come on, this is, I think that even rubbed off on my
thank you very much
on my parents. So maybe they're happy for this kind of grand gesture, but I don't, if you leave me, I'll leave you inside bungalow. I'm telling you, there's a time that I was perfectly okay living in my studio, because my studio was huge. It has over 12 rooms. I was fine staying in one. You understand? So I don't know, sir.
Fair enough. Okay, guys on Clubhouse, we're going to be leaving now. Just a teaser of the interview. You can catch the rest of it in a couple of days or weeks on the Black Box channel on YouTube. So thanks for listening in so far. And make sure you tune in when it's out. So we talked about your house. Still speaking of things you've posted, there was a video you posted, I think it was the day before Valentine's Day, of your brother putting a gift for himself at the door. And coming out to surprise himself.
Yes,
and I see a lot of those kind of posts on your page about your family, you know, your brother, your mom, your dad. So I get a sense that you're very
family.
Yeah.
Yes. Family oriented. And it was Christmas. And this is Christmas period, so my parents were around. My parents live in Dublin.
Okay.
My mom, my dad, my sister. So
how many are you?
Okay, four kids.
Okay.
My immediate younger brother, which is James, his son as well was around. So they were doing a lot of skits together as well during the Christmas holiday.
What was growing up like with your siblings and your parents?
Amazing. Beautiful.
Where did you grow up?
Two places, Ajegunle and Egbeda.
Okay.
First, Ajegunle. I was born in Ajegunle, and, you know.
Ajegunle has produced stars.
Yes. Ajegunle has.
So you were born in Ajegunle, then when did you move?
I moved to Egbeda when I was, okay, so hold on, let me count it, because Charles was 5, so if Charles was 5, so I was 11.
Okay. Yeah. So what are your memories of Ajegunle?
Memories of Ajegunle was 40s. Yeah, pretty much that, or 5. School, which was primary school. Come back home, follow my dad to the farm, which was at the back of the house. Then come back in the night, join my mom, and my mom sells akara in front of the house. Then in the morning, we can get up, me and this one, that's James, the other one. We can walk to go and carry agidi. We used to go and carry the agidi from the woman that my mother used to order it from. They used to make it early in the morning, like hot, it's hot, so it's still like pap. So we'll not carry it and come back home before it turns to like echo, and then go to school and come back. So it was school, church, farm,
Agidi,
and music.
Okay.
Music, our church is church. I'll call it church. Let me not call it music. It's church, but then I loved playing music.
So your dad was a farmer?
My dad, once upon a time, was a banker. Once upon a time, he decided that he don't want to go to bank again. So he became artist manager. He had one artist guy. His name is Dirty Dusty. So, you know, they used to go to studio, they used to try and do things. They didn't really blow like that. But my dad was very, My dad is somebody that in any organization that he is in, for some reason they make him the leader because he's very outspoken, he's very intelligent, he reads a lot and things like that. So, yeah, so once upon a time he was doing that. But even before you get to that place, so in between, from back before the artist manager team bloomed a little bit, there was famine in India.
Okay.
Yeah. So in that farming too, they were in a, they started a group called AFAM Cooperative. So it was Ajegunle Farmers Association of Nigeria, AFAM Cooperative.
Yeah.
And he was like the president at that time. So he used to come to my house and come and do like meetings. AFAM Cooperative. But we used to go to the, so the back of like the our houses then was like swamps and this is, so they turned them into farmlands.
What kind of things did
he put? Sugarcane, tomato, ugu, things like, but a lot of sugarcane.
Yeah. Interesting.
Yes, my dad used to donate sugarcane to like our church and they used them for like all those festivals that we do. Yeah.
So, well, and your mom sold akara and agidi?
My mom used to sell akara, fried yam, plantain, agidi in the night.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So when you talk about this church and music, what was that?
Cherubim and Seraphim.
Cherubim and Seraphim. Yeah. What was happening there with music?
Just young men wearing white garments going to church and playing their.
Because I know the Cherubim and Seraphim, they're known for their.
We dance and
play, jiving.
We play our hands away. You understand? So in like the early days, it was pretty much percussions and stuff. One of my favorite instruments is the percussion. So it was pretty much percussion. I think I am the best percussion player in the world. Or the percussionist in the world.
Really?
I think so.
So you're putting it out there now?
I think so. I'm very bad actually, but I even hold back. So okay. No, for percussions, I like percussions. I used to be very good growing up as a child, but after a while I pulled back.
Yeah. You
know. But then in the adult days, when the church started progressing, then drums started like coming. I'm like,
so you
moved
to other.
The jazz set. Now, funny enough, in my head, I could play the jazz drum, and I could play the bass guitar already before I even saw one in real life. For some reason, I don't know. I don't understand it. Maybe if anybody can help me out, if you're like a musician or something, if I don't know.
So are you saying the first time you ever touched those things,
I could play something? You understand? I've been seeing people play. I've seen people play, I've watched TV, and I've seen it, but I was like, the day I'm going to hold a bass guitar up close, I'm going to play doom 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 doom. It's easy, it's pretty much easy.
Like, and you did?
Yes! So, the drums came in handy, that one, it came in easily. Obviously, you get better as you grow older.
So you were in the choir is what I'm getting. When did you join the choir? What age? Do you remember?
All those things do not have date of start.
For as long as you've known you were in the choir.
I swear, all those things do not have date of start. I just know that I used to sing and they used to use me and replace people. My is that because I could, 1 minute I could be treble, 1 minute I could be alto, 1 minute I could be tenor, 1 minute. Bass was not really that because my voice was so obviously.
Yeah.
So the choir master can want to complete something. This thing, maybe they're telling you, you do so do la la la, do so family. They would not be doing something. They would not be there. Michael, go and join the.
the assistant of everything.
So if I do that one, I get it well. So after a while, they say, okay. So the tribal people are not really strong. So Mike, you will join them. For some reason, I was just saying, my mom was a good alto. She was like very dope.
So was everybody in your house in the choir?
My dad used to play percussions as well.
Okay.
My mom, alto, singer, and then myself.
Okay. So your dad managed artists, played instruments, you were in the choir doing a lot of things. Did you at any point at that time think that this might be? Mm-mm. You were just doing it?
I was just doing it. Obviously, I didn't understand like that, where we even begin to understand like that.
Yeah.
Listen, it's not the kind of pop that by the way, I'm just saying.
It's too deep.
Before you people make me lose the endorsement, it's not the kind of cup that you should drink this to.
No, this is a safe space. Don't judge him.
So, what were you saying before? I was rudely interrupted.
By yourself. Mm. Okay, let's just, so I'm getting a sense from what you're saying that Ajigunle didn't necessarily pass through you.
Pass through me how?
Like, you know, there's a perception of what Ajigunle people are, good or bad. You know, you learn, you're on the streets, you learn, you're street smart, you know, but I'm getting a sense that
you still get to be street smart. Are you kidding? You still get to be street smart, but...
like, were you sheltered, is what I'm saying?
My parents were, yes. I will say that, I will say my Ajogule is, that the showcase is Ajogule, obviously. It's like my... I don't know how I related, but I related.
That is Shoki?
Yes. Sir.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay, that's interesting. How can you not know how you're related?
My dad knows how to explain it.
But you're actually related?
Yes. This is my senior bros.
So why haven't you done anything together?
It just hasn't happened.
Mm-hmm. Would you like to?
Now that I've come back to start producing like that, maybe.
Why not?
Why not?
Yeah.
Nothing is impossible.
So what informed the move to Egbeda from
Growth? Growth. Like my dad.
The farm thing Afan had was no more cooperative.
But he started doing some other businesses. I think they gave us quit notice.
Okay.
Or something like that. I can't remember that from that other house. So my dad now told us that we're going to the airport. That's what he said. Why you laugh? My dad now said that we're going to this new house. That this place that we're going to, that we'll be seeing aeroplane, we'll just be flying
on top
of our house. And true.
And that is true.
You see, but it was a brother that we moved to. That time, a brother still had like red sand.
Uh-huh.
You see how like red sand. But it was chassis close to Kenya.
Yeah.
So, thank God, Sha.
So, what school did you go to in Ajegunle?
Awodiora Primary School.
Okay. By Agbeda, were you had gone into secondary school?
I went to another Ebenezer. Something.
Yeah.
Primary school, but then I now went from there. No, it was secondary school, but then I did like 1 year or so. Then I went to Ijaniki.
To Ijaniki, yeah. So by the time you took better, I mean, you had not left your church where you were, you know, assistant of everything. Did you continue in Ekbeda?
We kept going there.
You kept going back?
Today.
You still go back there?
Yes, once in a blue moon.
Okay. So you never left?
No, it's still our church. I was born there.
Okay.
We still go there. If I hear, it's in Ajegunle. There. We go there. My brother goes more than me, but I do go once in a while.
Yeah, interesting.
But because we are now on the island, sometimes because House of the Rock is not so far, we just go to House of the Rock. Sometimes I'll just log on to internet and be looking at Banky. Sometimes. Why are you laughing? Sometimes like go to this president's house. You know, far from my studio. Only far from my studio before. Yeah. So when I was staying in my studio, this present house was like 5 minutes away, so I used to just go there in the morning. But then, after a while, we now started using internet. Internet age has come, so we now started watching it in the internet. Now I could go watching it on the internet because of COVID anyways. So
exactly.
And we're still feeling the presence of the Lord.
So when you went to Ijaniki, were you classmates or friends with Osi?
Yes.
You were classmates with him?
Yes. Very much.
Yeah.
Once upon a time was like my best friend as well.
Oh, interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Who else was there that we might know?
That you might know. Hey. I don't know who you people know again. No. It was mainly Osi.
Yeah.
It was mainly Osi. That anybody in the industry that you people know. No. No, I don't know anyone that
What was Ijaniki like? Because this is, I mean, from Ajigunle, Egbeda, a federal secondary school, at least back in the day, was this melting pot of different people from all across the country.
The vibe was Popsi had strived, you know, Momsi has strived, and all their aim was to make sure that we all went to good schools. They made sure that no matter how the band would be like that, I keep telling people that as I was growing up and I was living in this Ajegunle and better and this thing, it's now that I knew that I was suffering. I did not know that I was suffering.
Does it feel better?
Yeah, I didn't. I was fine. It wasn't that crazy. This thing. I'm always like, I don't know how to speak the English. Content. Whatever. I just know how to. So anyone, yeah. So I pretty much was going with the flow. So at this point now that we were in school, we were just happy that my parents, at least they brought us to a place where we could mix with people that. People will say they have future. Because my parents divided us into two people went to Idaniki and two people went to King's College.
Okay.
Yes.
So was music still going on in Idaniki for you?
See, they can't report me. But I was even like, if you can come and report me that, okay, I skipped classes. But the first thing my dad would ask you is, where was he? When they skipped the class, they said, they say it was in the music hall. Okay.
So, all the while, your dad.
He already knew that.
That's where you were going.
Any other thing was not entering.
But he thought you were going
to. No, it was not like it was not entering because I know book, but my music, I won't know. When when I started feeling, which was like SS2 to the end, pretty much, I was feeling on purpose.
Because you just didn't want to do it anymore.
Mm. I was doing it to join some bad gang people.
You and Osi?
No, Osi. Me and Osi were in what do you call it, music group together. The music group is called Ministration Voices. We used to sing, we used to write songs.
How many were you?
7. We used to sing and write songs, amazing songs. See, I've written hit songs before. I will ask you, tell you. I've written hit songs before. That is that blue everywhere.
So. Ministration Voices sounds like a gospel.
But yes, it's gospel. Now, did I tell you that it wasn't anything?
Where are they now?
We're all friends. Everybody do different things. This OC is acting now. Yeah. If you leave him now, he will do gospel too. So when we got to that SS2,
yeah,
towards the end, so I come backslide. This thing, just because I wanted to join some other guys that were into some other form of music, and then for some form of protection,
yeah,
as well. Because the guy, you go just now, we don't like girls. You go like the wrong girl. They go some boys with all those boys then wait all those boys with our pocket money.
They can't be their girlfriend.
No, they can't go be their girlfriend. Then they will come get a hand. They won't beat you and stuff. So for protection, I had to protect myself with the people that I knew that could protect me. Which
these were students, yeah.
Yes, they were students.
But they were hard guys.
Yes. Strong. So I now became friends with the strongest boy in the school. He was strong. Nia Delusi. He was so strong.
Nia Delusi, where are you?
He was so strong. And then Nia Delusi was strong. Like he used to lift, do all those weightlifting and this thing. But then his voice is like Waneko.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Was he Ministration Voices?
No. So he liked that I loved music. And I could pat him when he was singing. As they sing, so I go, they harmonize, you know. Yeah. How does that mean you had to do?
Don't say.
So as they sing, I go, they harmonize. I will help him write songs. Him too was a good songwriter as well.
Yeah.
This thing, but then he was strong. So he made sure that he protected me from all those people.
Yeah. Did you have a girlfriend then? Or did you collect somebody's girlfriend?
They did not like me, though.
Why?
Can't you see my face? I don't find. I don't get. I don't find. They don't like me. They don't like me. It's business. That was the most problem. That's why now two people are rushing me to get married. I'm like, what's wrong with you people? They don't see me before. You are not stressing my life.
did they ever tell you that?
That was.
As in, did girls tell you then that you were not fine? Is that, I mean, you're saying that you don't see my face?
Did they used to say it with mouth? They used to say it with eye now.
Wait, so you went through Ijaniki without a girlfriend?
No girlfriend, no. I like people, but they don't like me back, to be honest. I don't want to start naming names. But they know themselves. As I talk like this, so now, maybe by tomorrow they'll DM me.
Some don't reach out since then.
We talk. But tomorrow night, this was what I talk about that. You DM me. You say, hey, you are talking about us already. Everybody, it is what it is.
So it didn't bother you then? Or how did you get through it? Because the truth is, as a teenager, there are certain things that gives you confidence or makes you feel like you have levels. And having a babe then was like a thing. Do you ever feel...
I don't get the confidence. So yes, it affects you. Fine. So part of those things... Maybe you can't follow for the reasons why I don't really like interviews now.
Yeah.
You follow for the reasons why I don't really like talking in public places.
Yeah.
You follow for...
the like, you're very shy.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. So, it's all those things, yes, it does affect you, yeah.
So you were used to just being on your own, or...?
Make I just day my day, make I do all right. This thing. And see, tomorrow, no matter now, even now, God said, ask my friends that know me. I don't know how much you... You want to tell me that you love me, this.
Yeah, don't move.
It doesn't really sink in.
That's a long time ago.
I don't really believe like that. So, but I don't need anybody to pity me. I'm fine. I don't need anybody to pity me. I don't need anybody to pity me. Number one, number two, I don't need anybody to come and say that, he has what they call that, baggage.
What do you call like that? Baggage from your childhood.
Say that baggage. Yeah, carrying baggage. Trauma for it. Oh, man, if you mean that.
No, but obviously you do.
It don't happen. Who cares? Please, I beg. Moving on. I beg, Darren.
Is it not something you think you want to deal with?
You don't turn what do they call
therapist.
Name? Therapist. You don't turn Dr. 5'2".
No, but seriously, it's not something you want to deal with.
Deal with what?
Because if it's something that you said happened for a period of time and still sort of affects you now.
Wow, affect us. Affectability. No, it's fine. I'm fine. I'm actually... It's okay. It may actually just turn me into... I don't want to say some form of a monster. It's not a monster. It just made me to start seeing things early.
Yeah.
Yeah, it just... I see things differently. Sometimes people are not really what they seem or what they claim to be. This is so maybe
nothing surprises you.
You know, this I don't surprise me.
Anyway, so we talked earlier about, you know, when you were in Ajegunle, music, you were not necessarily thinking about the future of being an artist. By Janiki, were you thinking that way already? When did you start feeling okay, this might be? Because if you're stabbing class to go to the music.
I was thinking of the moment. I was just thinking of the moment. It's not like I was thinking about career. You're
just enjoying it.
Yeah, I was enjoying it while we were doing it.
Then you were still just having fun. In
it. Yeah, I was still having fun.
So when you...
When I did not even think that music was...
A thing.
Going to be like a job or a thing until I moved to London, which was
much later.
This thing was when it now became this is the thing that you're going to use to get pound sterling. Okay,
let's do it now.
Then I'm like, okay.
So when you were deliberately failing in SS2, what was your plan?
So they would just bring test sheet or whatever. You showed me and people used to bet first to finish, first to go and submit. This thing, it was ridiculous. I don't understand. It's like they did to do for me. This thing, especially the final exam, what do you call it?
WAEC.
Yes.
So you didn't have any plan. You just wanted to fail and do what?
It's not like I wanted to. I don't even think about it. Yeah. I was like, let me go and submit.
There was no plan. Mm. What were your parents saying?
At this time, they're coming in, they beat me.
But still, don't send again this time.
They're coming in, beat me. They beat me. Because I had no book.
Yeah.
So it was very confused at some point now. It wasn't. They beat me. You know the problem, self. There was one result. I can't remember if it was the SS3-1 or the second term one or something. That they used to put. I came home to my dad and I gave them a
Quiet, GC, Mock.
I don't know. Shaq, one of them. Shaq came back home, man, and I gave them one fake result.
Where you pass?
I didn't even really do well. They beat me.
What was the point of a fake result where you didn't do well?
That's what I'm saying. This particular fake result, they still beat. They beat me for that.
And the real one was worse.
Wait, nah. My dad now went to visit my younger sister in school, and they had posted our real results in the in the notice board. So when did that go there? Then that my sister was like to my dad that don't say how Mike just disgrace us because they post the results
and everybody
sees
it.
So but my sister was still in school, me and I come out now. So you say, I said, Mike, go disgrace us because the result is new. This is my dad because we saw it too. Anyway, maybe at least he even got once or something. I can't remember how I even put it.
I have so many questions for God.
Don't worry yourself. At least he even got
one credit
and one A or something. I put A somewhere. And my sister said, what? 4P, 4F, 4C. The thing that's traumatized my sister to the point that she has crammed this in her head. And I said, what do you mean?
Hey, what did you have a C?
Igbo. No, I can't remember if it was Igbo or Yoruba, all of them both. Yes. My sister said, what do you mean? What before ever? I was like, ridiculous. So, my dad then went there and I copied the real results. And I came home. He just dropped everybody. Hello, see, that's your result. Maybe you copied the person that was below you. He said, maybe you copied the person that was below you. Maybe because you see, turn your eye. So then you copied the one. But that beat me the beat already. He said, it wasn't double job party. They don't beat me the beat already. So, you see, my sister was not having it.
The one question I have is, if you are going to fake a result, why did you not make it good?
I didn't want to make it too...
too unbelievable.
Too unbelievable from the last one.
Where is that? Did it go from?
I didn't want to make it too unbelievable from the last one. But my dad was very pissed because all growing up from primary school to secondary school, I had a pass well. I know book when I was small. But now I don't know book again. Yeah, so he was very upset. He was very upset. But then later on, I had to make up with my early knowledge of computer sciences. I went finished from there, and I went to Lagos State Computer Science,
With that result, you couldn't apply to any university.
I went to Lagos State Computer College first. Then at some point, I shall made up because he now was like, oh, he likes computer, this one. So the computer and the music was making up for my stupidity.
So what was the plan now with the computer knowledge at that time?
At that particular time, I'm going to do Redeem Flyer and... why did I... what did they do?
All those flyers.
Then I wish to do all this.
Printing.
Flyer, Awake. What do they call it? Then you go see, then you go to type audio coursework. Maybe they give people for school, and then you go just do plenty CV.
One small business center.
Business center. My auntie had one business center, so I went to that business center to start working small. So you can do people CV. You can use Microsoft Word. I've been doing all those things.
Did you do that?
Yes, I did that.
For how long?
Short, maybe 6 months, not that long. But then when I got to London, there was one time that my uncle used to brag to people and say, do you have any computer work that you want to do? Just come and give it to Michael. He's a computer wizard. He can open email for you. See, really, I'm serious. He used to say that. Just, he can open email for you now. Just tell him now, you open it.
Please, what year was it?
crazy times. In the beginning, it was the world. In the beginning, it was the world. That was the internet just the start that time. Man.
I remember that time we used to pay people to open emails.
Exactly. Yeah, that's
business center.
Exactly.
My very first email, I actually paid for it.
Exactly. That's what I'm telling you. That's what I'm telling you. I didn't open email for you. That shit was crazy.
Oh my God. So, this business center thing, after that, what happened? You say you were there for 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
And then?
Then you obviously start doing exam. You did one more exam.
Okay, you retook GCE and all of that.
Yep. Then I went to Ekpoma 1 year. Wasn't working.
What were you studying there?
Business admin.
Business admin, okay.
So.
Oh, you went to Ekpoma?
Yes.
I didn't know that.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, opportunity came for me to go to London. My uncle. He took me, and that was
after the 1 year.
Yeah.
So you were going to just move to London, or were you just traveling to come back?
Traveling first to see if there's like a school that you can move into.
Okay, to transfer to.
To transfer to. But after a while.
Did you even try to go to
music? I tried.
Okay.
I went to sixth form. I went to sixth form. Then it wasn't working though.
Then?
Music.
And how many emails did you open first with your uncle?
I opened a lot for my people. So yeah, we just stayed there. I stayed long enough. I met the band after a while.
Yeah.
I came back to Nigeria.
So you're in London now, because I know I've heard stories about, you know, you playing in the church there as well or
mm-hmm,
something.
Mm-hmm.
And then meeting Solek, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
So you found another Cherubim and Seraphim church there.
Yes. Yes.
And you continued what you were doing here.
I continued what I was doing, but then my own church was not paying me money.
Okay.
But one man in the church there now told me about other churches that would gladly pay me to come and...
So you snitched on your church?
No, so I did not. It's not like I did. What I did was I thought there were some young children. There were some young children inside my own church, and I taught them how to play the guitar, the piano, the drums to make the church, you know, blow some. The good thing is that this my church, this particular church in London. It's the same song that they used to sing every Sunday. The same song that they used to sing. The rest should change.
Once you learn it, you've learned it.
Once you learn it. So when I taught these children, I was like, you see this thing that I taught you how to play to this song? This song that... Praise the Lord always. As I taught you to play this guitar, that's the only thing you can play. So don't go and tell people outside that you can play this guitar. You can only play Praise the Lord. But they could play the amount of songs that... You know,
so which church did you move to?
I didn't care too tough for their names. I didn't move to the churches. I was just going when they come here, I'll come and play.
So you played every Sunday at different churches or one other church?
Yes, different Sundays at different churches, and the churches was not really the main thing. The guy also had like friends that were playing in. Parties,
okay,
like weddings and this juju music and stuff like that. So it was like, I was going to introduce me to some other guys. So he introduced me to the guys that were playing for Jide Cord. There's this legendary juju artist, his name is Jide Cord. So he introduced me to the guys that were playing for Jide Cord. That was where I met Soji Solek,
Yeah,
because Solek was playing saxophone for the GD chord guy.
Okay.
Me, I was playing bass guitar for the GD chord guy. So the two of us now met, we were like, oh, that he's trying to form a band, that he sings as well. He's trying to form a band, that can we form something, you know, I'm going to be performing at restaurants and stuff like that. So I was like, ah, fine, if you can sing, no wala. Then Soji used to have like this keyboard where you could program beats on top there. I was like, okay, he taught me how to program on top of the keyboard, and then I became the beats man. Yeah. That's the point where I actually now started programming beats on top keyboards.
Yeah.
Because I just had the knowledge of what the bass guitar is supposed to do, the drums is supposed to do, the keyboard is supposed to do. So I was just making music.
Yeah. Before we get to that, how much were the churches paying you?
£150.
£150 per session.
Per song.
And it was just the bass guitar for the bass guitar.
Yes.
And how much were you getting?
Between £150 to £250, depending on the church, depending on how much money they
are. So during the week, what do you do?
During the week, I was doing like different other jobs. those different other jobs.
Like, I don't know.
You don't know all the jobs that need to be in London.
I don't know.
You do different other jobs that will make you survive. McDonald's, you go and work, security job, packing job, you know.
You were a security where? Yeah. You were security?
Yes. Okay. No, I don't deserve a person if you're security. Yes, all these security jobs now, you know what happened, actually? Let me just break this security job thing. My uncle.
The same uncle?
Yes. My uncle went to go and tell this man that I can open email for him or whatever. So that man that put me inside his office, he runs a security firm. So that put me inside his office as one of the people in the office that used to take bookings, write email, do CV, do just the type things for inside office. But now, one security guy that was supposed to go to one uncompleted building to secure the place now called in sick. So we were now short of security people that were supposed to go to that place. So they now went to go and replace me with that. They said we can take one uniform. We can go replace the guy. That's why I go co-working. So from tryout, that's how it just became
a permanent.
That became a permanent something. Ah, all right. But there's one day that racist children wanted to use stone and kill me in Bemonzi. One place called Bemonzi. And that. Why are you stoning? Because you stone with egg. Because
you stand for road.
Just because you're a black man. Why are they doing that? This is just disturbing. You just be stoning. This is so. Now, I want one day when I come back out, all my face, all my body, everywhere, down white.
I don't go fit to this thing.
I don't do it again. There.
How long were you security for?
Maybe like 2 months.
Do you remember your salary?
No, I can't remember. That one is per hour.
Okay.
Per hour, I can't remember.
What about McDonald's? How much were you paid?
It was also per hour. It was maybe just $4.50 per hour. Then
yeah. Were you a waiter or were you washing dishes?
I did two. There was one that I was doing burger, and there was one that they sent my security to the place. To another branch, obviously.
So you were security at McDonald's and you flipped burgers as well?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Anyway, so when this when you met Jide
then Code, then there's packing. You know, like all those back in the day, the internet then was like AOL, American Online or something. Yeah. Like that. So the CDs used to, like, we were the ones that used to just carry the CDs and put them inside the packet, and we'll put them inside the things that they should send to people to go and put in their computers to get them get internet. Yeah, so those packing jobs. I used to work there.
So when you met Jide Code,
yes,
were you paid per session as well?
Or no, how did that work? That one is per gig.
Per gig, whatever gig you get. Yeah. Are you getting a commission or a set pay?
No, set pay.
Of how much?
It depends. About 150 to 200, 250.
Yeah. All this while, are you living with your uncle or did you have your own place at this time now?
So it was half with my uncle. Sometimes, in the early stages, was with my uncle. Then after a while, I moved to Camberwell. I was on my own.
Yeah. So there was no plan to go back to school anymore?
School, girl. Really school. Anyway, at this time, I already started seeing small pounds. I was taking care of the people that were left in Nigeria.
Yeah.
My brother liked the fact that I used to send the money.
Yeah. So at this point still, there's still no plan to go into music.
This is not the music that I was doing.
You were just doing the live band with
Jide Code. Yeah, it was just live band something. I didn't think about it as going into go and wax record.
You were just doing it, yeah.
I was just doing it as they go live. I was a music live performer, sectionist, going kill and destroy and bounce.
About how old were you at this time?
Now I was 19, 20.
Ah, okay. So about till 20, there was still no, I'm going to be Don Jazzy.
No.
You are just still.
I'm going to be Don Jazzy manifested in when I was 23.
Okay. So like.
But my son, my nickname has been Don Jazzy from secondary school.
Okay.
So. Long story. It was Don Jazzy for something else.
For what?
Nickname, like, then you get nickname.
So you were called Don Jazzy all this while?
Yes, sir. I was called different thing. At once upon a time, I was called Arrow. At that time, then I was called Don Jazzy. Don Jazzy now stuck.
What does Arrow mean? You called Arrow. Sounds like an interesting story.
I was called Arrow because of, I think, this movie. There was one movie that I think it was
Black Arrow. Yeah. That was his name.
Yes, I just liked his name.
Yeah. Okay, I remember that. Okay, so when you decided to start this thing with, so like you say, that was the first time you started making beats. Did you learn this? How did you just start?
Like I said, if somebody's gonna explain it to me. It's why it is today. If somebody tells me, "Oh, come and teach me how to produce," I don't really understand what you mean by that.
Yeah,
because for some reason, music has just been.
It's just there.
It's just been in there. If I pick, there's no instrument in the world that I can pick that I'll pick up now. If any instrument whatsoever, just give me 20 to 30 minutes. I should be able to use it and make beats. You understand? I might not be an expert at it or whatever, but I can use it to create beats. It's not that crazy.
Yeah. Mm. So you just saw it and knew what to do.
If I toy around with it for a while, yes.
So were you guys a band, a duo?
For Solek.
Yes.
Yeah, Solek Crew.
Okay, it was called Solek Crew.
Yeah, Solek Crew because of So Solid Crew.
Okay.
That year.
So you guys were playing at events?
Yeah, it was three of us. So there was me, Mikey, there was two Michaels and Soji.
More money, obviously, this time than GD Code's band.
Yes, it became better. It became more constant. We could play. We now had different places that we were playing on Thursdays, Fridays,
like Saturdays. Standard.
Yes, regularly. Like we had like different restaurants plus like Saturdays and Sundays was now for weddings and birthdays and stuff. But then standard was Thursday, Friday restaurants. Sure, at the point we had Wednesday. This is if we wanted Monday and Tuesday, I'm sure we'd have got it, but.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but yeah, it was good and it was good money too.
Yeah.
Because we used to perform, it was just three of us. I would have programmed the beat on the keyboard, and while we were playing, I used to play the drums on the keyboard. Like I see you feel as if a live band is playing and a gongo is playing at the same time. It was mad. Yeah, so we started earning monies, moved per gig to minimum 500, 600 bucks, sometimes 1,000, depending on how people spray money at the wedding or the party or the whatever that you go to.
So at this point, of course, security, McDonald's.
No,
don't move.
No, don't go.
So how did this JJC meeting happen?
At some point, the leader of the band, which was Soji, he's the lead singer, he sings. So he decided that he didn't want to do like a crew anymore. If you look at Shino Peters and his band, if you look at Ebenezer and his band, so he had his dream is valid. So he decided that he wanted to be Mr. Soji and his band or Solek and his crew or whatever. The case maybe I didn't take it well at that time.
So he basically scattered your people's business plan.
I would say like he scattered. Yeah.
Can we not get contracts?
Yeah, there was no contract. I was upset, but at some point when you grow up, you realize okay, you were together before. Now he wants to be on his own. He wants to be on his own, and that's
yeah.
So he moved on, and then that's when JDC found me.
Okay, how did he find you?
Interesting story. So while I was doing Solek, Cass found me. Cass Beats,
yeah.
came to me. He used to come and watch us perform, and he was like overwhelmed. Like, the way I used to perform, it was crazy. I should just stay in that place and wear my bandana. Sometimes I'll wear singlet. I'll just be performing, and there'll be one bottle of whiskey. whiskey on the table there, and I'll just be performing. I'll be drinking anyhow. But Cass liked the way I used to. Then he found out that I was the one that made the beats that we were using to perform all those juju music that we were doing. Then we used to do those juju music at the same time. Then at some point we used to perform like R&B songs, hip hop songs, like covers,
yeah,
and stuff. But then we don't have the instrumental of those songs, so I will remake the beats for Solek to perform it. So Cass now was like, oh, I heard that I'm the one that made the beats and this thing, that he would like for me to produce for him. I said, produce.
That's the first time you heard.
Yeah. I don't understand. What do you mean?
What year was this? 2003?
About that, maybe I'm 22 now. So that's 2002. Okay. 2002. So I'm not really very good with dates and things like that. So, yeah. And I said that he wants me to produce. I said, well, I don't understand what you mean. I said, I know that I know how to do beat. One beat.
The beat produce with it.
He said, something like that. Make I don't do beat for that. I said, okay, fine. I can do it on top of this keyboard. How are you going to put it to CD? He said, okay. I should do it on top of the keyboard. No problem. Like, he will go and look for how you put it to the CD. He came to my house. I made the beat on top of the keyboard. He carried the keyboard. He went to studio.
He carried the keyboard?
Yes. He carried the keyboard. He went to one studio, one Jamaican guy's studio. The Jamaican guy now stripped the audios of the... Now, it's not... I think about it now. So, it's not that I understand. But then... I don't know that he went out, he came back with song. His voice was now on top of the his voice was on top of the
beat.
Better, on top of the beat. I said, that song go.
So that fascinated you, of course. Did he pay you?
No, he didn't.
Oh, it was just a favor.
No, he wasn't. We were just doing that.
Okay. So
I was like, okay, fine, no problem. We can do more then. So in his freestyle, we'll come around. I'll make beats on top of the keyboard. You carry the keyboard, you go and give it to the Jamaican friend, you turn it to CD. It became like that until we made a single for him, one song that he liked, Secret Lover. Yeah. So he now, Cass is also a DJ, but he's the funniest DJ that you ever meet. Now, you see, Cass, you know, DJs, you have to play what you think that the people, the crowd, they like. I'll be sorry, the crowd, you can get them going. Yeah, you're joking around. Cass plays exactly what he likes in his head. He does not care
what the club wants or he what does anybody not care wants.
What is that? I used to be there and I'll be shy. This is Cass can go from go shoddy, it's your birthday, we gonna party like it's on Fiki Fiki Johnny, man. He was not destined. And nobody. No. Because he loves Indian movies. He can inside the club. Oh, people will be inside the club. Cars will just switch the music to any Indian song that comes. Oh, Mary Mebuba, Mebuba, Mebuba. I'm like, what? Are you serious? Yeah. So, he went to one wedding to perform as a DJ, and in that wedding as well, JDC was present in that wedding. JDC, they had blown as skills from Big Brothers at that time.
Yeah.
So we knew of them, like, you know, just Big Brothers guys in the UK. They say we were local champion, them, they were already in the mainstream in that world. So Cass went to a Nigerian wedding. Luckily for them, JDC was there, and Cass was there. Cass was the DJ, so Cass now decided to play songs. As he was playing, he just put his own music inside there. Mm-hmm. Don't care whether the music is big, right? I'm blow, right? No blow. Just play his own song. Yeah. So while he played the song, JDC, being a music man, could tell that this was a Nigerian song or whatever, but he liked the beat for some reason. And we went to Cass. Apparently, I don't know if they met before or something. So he was like, oh, nice song. This is, oh, that is him. That's a song. This is. Say, oh, nice. And I suggest he was like, who produced the record?
Yeah.
So Cass, I said, oh, that is this guy with Sulek crew. This thing. This was like, oh, we had heard about B before. I think they've got as solo crew at this point, we do not really care about the mainstream, but then we don't blow.
As upon ahead.
No, we don't blow at this point. And from when we had Alayo Mini and some other big songs, we don't blow. So we're going for every wedding and no wedding. If your wedding is not called solo crew at this time, this thing, we perform for Obasanjo's daughter's wedding. See, we don't blow that time for London. So there was the local guys, the local Nigerian Fuji Juju music guys. Then there was the hip hop Nigerian team that was brewing.
Yeah.
So JDC was now in answer to Cass. So at that time he was looking for some sort of a producer partner, a producer that could join him, work with him, because he used to work with some other guy before from one African country, Uganda or something. His name is Fingers or so. So, but he needed somebody else that could join him together and they will make beats. So he told him that, okay, could you come to the studio and bring me? So that's what Cass told me. But when Cass told me, I don't believe, because I don't used to believe anything.
And at this point, Solek was over, like you said.
Yeah, so Solek was over. At this point, Solek was over. I was suffering. And now... At this point, so like, if I don't have money again. Fuck, you can imagine going from 500 to £1,000 per gig in the weekend, like in the weekend, £3,000 down complete. What did they use the money to do? I was just gathering some money, sending to my father, my mother, my brother, or Flanger, or whatever.
So nothing.
It just seized halfway. So Ogbeni, suffer. I remember at some point I even went back to the solicitor to beg for money. He gave me money.
Oh, wow.
Of course, sir.
How long were you out of the band for before the JJC thing?
I don't remember.
Months, yeah.
Maybe. No, not up to a year.
A couple of months.
Mm.
Okay, so he tells JJC, then you go to the studio, then what happened?
I went to the studio. They said I should come and make beats. I now told him, there's something about me, see, I'm very blunt, though. I'll tell you exactly as it is, because I don't know how to... Add code, sugar code to the thing. So I said, I don't know. I've never seen computer before. Which one are you showing me computer?
This is. For you to produce. Yeah, so you piano.
I know computer for making word and writing.
And open email.
You say, I should come and make beats. Now, at this point, produce is not production. I'm like, yo, I used to make beats on top. Did I tell you before? I used to make beats on top piano. And I said, no, that it's okay, that he's going to teach me my way around. I said, okay, no one, if you teach me this is so okay. I said, okay, you put the computer on. I said, okay, give me kick, give me snare, give me hi-hat, give me bass, give me piano. That's how I begin. And I made the wackest beat ever in the history. In the history of human being. I said, oh, okay, no problem. Now we get a hang of it that it happens. He said, but it's okay. No, that what's going to happen is that. So he had two studios. There was one major studio in this floor, and then upstairs there's one other smaller studio. That he had some people that were training there. That I should go there and join them. Maybe in like 3 to 6 months, that I will get a hang of it. Then I can come down to the big studio, and join them. And that's not a problem. No, well, let me go. And I went upstairs, and I saw the people. I didn't come. After that first day, I went home. I don't come again. I felt ill. I don't come again for like a week or two. He called me again. He said, "I'm fine. I will not see you again." This. I said, "I don't know if I really see you like that. I just, especially with that beat you do." He said, "No, that should come around. That that it happens. That this." So I came, Sha. I went to that upstairs. when I went to that upstairs, and I saw the boys, they were there, they were trying making beats, because they know how to look, use computer. They were making beats, but I did not understand music like that. The beats were not really sounding. I just needed somebody to show me really well how the computer works. You see, 2 days. Not even the 3 or 6 months. I started making fire from that up there. Nobody told us to move me
back down immediately.
Nobody told us to move me down there. You see, like 1 week, I had already contributed to doing a song for Lamar back then.
Yeah.
This is, so he was like, you can come down now. This is, so I came downstairs, I joined him, started making a couple of records for some different people that you know and some that you don't know.
Like, who do we know besides Lamar?
Big Brothers. We did the soundtrack for Scooby-Doo movie at the time.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm.
And then we started working on the Backbone. The Big Brothers, the Backbone compilation album, and things like that. And then and some other artists. We worked with different other artists. So it was mostly white people that you guys might not have.
So you were making money again?
Not exactly. Later on, that money started coming. But at that point in time, I just wanted to make music, you know.
So the fire has started.
Mm-hmm.
At that point, now you knew you wanted to make music. So was it the studio that woke Don Jazzy?
Or no. What Don actually Jazzy was when I was about to leave Backbone.
Okay.
I would say I actually got awake because of the band, really.
Okay.
I was making different music for different people, but I didn't really care too tough about what it was, what it meant to people, how it was turning into money, how other stuff. I didn't really care until I wanted to make music for the band.
Yeah.
So
we've heard so many stories about how he used to come to the studio and just hang around.
Yes.
Which was exactly what it was.
Mm-hmm.
So what now took two of you out of the JJC and, you know, Big Brother setup?
Let me say miscommunication or misinformation. I don't know how I'm going to put it now, because this is about 20 years ago. Water under the bridge.
Yeah.
We don't grow. Some of us don't really understand. Now that I'm older, I didn't understand a lot of things growing up. I didn't understand how you just come into a man's life and decide that you're his partner. You understand? He wanted to work with me.
That's JJC.
Yeah, that's JJC. We stayed in the studio and made music, a bunch of music. But for some reason, this is where I nowadays, if you want to do, there are some things that you want to do. In the contracts, you see there that this contract does not in any way mean that me and you are not partners.
Yeah.
You should see that.
Yeah.
Exactly. It's not that I understand. This is so, maybe, because you wanted to work with me, fine. Okay, you wanted to work with me. He's growing his empire or whatever. So you wanted to work with me in the capacity that, okay, yeah, just one of the producers has got to be under what I'm building or whatever. But for some reason, I felt it was a partnership. I mean, fuck up. Whatever the case may be. A contract was presented at some point that didn't indicate if I was some form of partner or not.
Yeah.
And what I was supposed to be getting from it, from what I had done in my time in the partnership, so to say, didn't make sense to me. You understand? Or it didn't make sense to even a bunch of us that were in the record label at the time. So all of them, some of them used to run around and be like, is that the kind of contract they gave me? They gave me like an artist contract. But I'm not an artist.
So this was not your first contract? When you came in, did you have a contract or you just started producing?
No, I don't have contract.
So you had been there for how long before this contract now came up?
About a year.
Okay. So you found out you were not a partner?
Something like that.
And then what happened? Oh, now you start fighting.
Ah. I don't know. It's not that crazy. I like being where I'm not wanted. If you stay, I don't know why people are in relationships that are not wanted. I don't know why people are just stay. Just give yourself an extra headache. Move. I like to believe that I am valuable.
Yeah.
I move. You understand? So, the moment I saw something that. I saw a contract that didn't depict what I thought I was, or whatever. Not only me, maybe even if it was in my head, the other people that were around too, they were all coming around and they were like, why did I have an artist contract? The artist contract that I'm not an artist. I only did one song. There was one song, Money or something, in the album, something, something. So that means I'm not really going to get any money. You understand? But I produced a lot of records.
So did you try to fix it at all, or you just walked?
I didn't understand. I didn't try to fix it. I walked because, it's 20 years down the line. See, it doesn't really matter.
At this point, you and the band were friends.
Me and the band were not really friends like that. We were not friends. It was coming around.
So was it coming around to do music?
It was coming around to join the Happening Guys.
Okay.
Then he's a cool, amazing guy. He used to make us laugh well.
He wasn't even trying to do music at this time.
He was trying to do music now, but we were not trying to produce for him. Because he was playing the harmonica then. There were people that were rapping and singing and doing things that time. We were in our own heads.
Yeah.
The Jerry Sam Formula squad, it was like a complete team already. So he came when the team was completed. Already, so in our head, we were not really focusing on extra people at that time. But then he was really persistent, very entertaining, and so we liked taking him around on the road,
yeah,
and stuff like that. So immediately I saw that thing, and when everybody was just telling me, like, it was like everybody was doing a yeah.
After all this year.
After all the work that you've done, this one, but I just didn't understand. Like I said, miscommunication, misinformation. I did not. Let me go to say, you don't turn partner, but you were not really partner. You were something else. You were growing, and somebody was training you. You understand? So it just got in my head. And maybe the other people felt close to me because now I understand this because I run.
Yeah.
I've run two successful record labels. Now I understand this, and I've worked with different producers under me, and I can see where things can get fucked up in your head.
Yeah.
Yes. So things got fucked up in my head. I didn't get it. Just, Benny, who are you? Now you build studio. Now you put lights. Now you like why you just assume that this is so I get it.
How did he take it?
There was no time to explain. Maybe he was a bigger person at that time than us. And she happens. Move on.
Were you guys cool after that? Or you just never saw?
We were not for some time, obviously. Because we left. Myself and the band, we now were like, okay, fuck it, we're going to go. So me, in anger, I felt like at the time, the Jerry Sam Formula squad, they were really trying because they were big in the UK, they were also trying to be big in Nigeria. So in anger, some form of, is it revenge? I won't say it's revenge or whatever, or just, small children with us, they told Trantum, we're going to be big too. This year, so fuck it, we're going to go to Nigeria now, and we're going to blow. So I took the band's project very personal.
So then I'm wondering, why the band? You say you are not friends.
I did not have any other. There was no artist again. Do you have artists?
So you guys were just cool, and you told him
we did not have artists. He was the closest person to me at the time. He was readily available, and yeah, it's we became friends. At that position, we became friends because contract didn't reach him too. Anyways,
yeah. So what was the plan now with both of you?
To go to Nigeria and conquer. I was like, yo, I'm going to take you to Nigeria. Oh, he was convincing me to go to Nigeria
okay.
already in the first place. I had not agreed until this point. So at this point, I was like, yo, that Nigeria that you want to go to, I'm going to go to that Nigeria, and I'm going to make it the youngest living legend at that time, because we were young.
Yeah. Because Nigerian music, of course, at that time had become, you were hearing about, you know, certain artists.
I was hearing about, it had gotten to Olufemi them time.
Okay.
That time oh Jesus. at that time I really loved Star Plus. I was like, this music doesn't make sense like that. It makes sense since, but yeah, it looks like more young people were getting into it and stuff like that. We could go and try. So I really took that No Long To Now album very personal.
So was more hits born in London or here?
Here.
Okay.
Yeah, we did the whole album, finished there
before
coming to Nigeria, before I now even knew what
we finished the album in London.
We finished the album in London 2 weeks.
Then came back.
And came back to Nigeria before I knew what really the record label was.
So what informed more hits?
We need to decide how I'm going to put out the music now. Then now decide, there's record label, there's this one, there's
I heard somewhere that you tried to sell your label to Obi Asika for $1 million.
Yep. It is what it is.
And he didn't buy it.
They were going to, but
so wait, you tried to sell the record label before the album came out or after?
No, by this time we don't even do Togolo.
So why were you trying to sell it then?
Why me no come?
So you never really see the potential.
Do you understand? We just knew that okay, money they come, but we need some money now at the moment. It's crazy. See this world. See some people want these artists. They maybe when they do one song, that is say this. By that time,
Tongolo was out. So what happened with Obi Asika?
We were going to. The world would happen is that money no day. Before we should just come to Nigeria, we'll spend money that fish, we'll go back to London, we'll try and gather some money, we'll come back again to push and go back. So as we came back, we were like, okay, let's just, I can't remember, was it 1 million or 2 million? I can't remember if it was 1 million or 2 million, to be honest. We made more hits and Storm at the time together so that I could be making the music for the Storm artists that they had.
Okay, at the time already.
At the time already. Collaboration things will be going on. And
what happened?
They were waiting. They were dulling me. They know. We'll go to the office in. There's one office in Vienna. There's one new one. It's not the house. There's one office in Vienna or Ikoyi, whatever. So I used to go there because we're not used to Ireland. That I used to live on the mainland, Maryland. So I don't know whether that Vienna or Ikoyi, one of their both. So we used to go there. They told us to see. Chill. Obi is busy. When is busy? No, I told her they do it
too. Tell her to see.
So it is what it was. So we were waiting for the money. Shall we try to come? We were waiting for the time when we would the synergy is kind of, you know, so that we just take the Nigerian industry by storm.
Yeah.
Then God just said, Anna, look at this. Oh, you little children of little feet.
Wait, who came up with the name Mohit?
Myself.
Okay. Why Mohit?
Because I just knew that I didn't make beats. Nah, and hits. I hit, they drop from my head. For some reason, I don't know how to say. You see, I used to tell people back in the days that, you know, because I went to Chilebina Seraphim, the kind of music that we should sing in Chilebina Seraphim, we need to do worship songs, like, you know, we worship you.
Groove.
We don't need to do all those songs. It's like, straight back, man, ding, ding, back, 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 back. So my beats are more like jumpy, dance, this. That's how I grew up. I don't know how to do all those slow dances. You know how, if you go to Cobham's now, you can get musical inspiration. Fine, thumbs up to you. No problem. But you see me, how I grew up, how I learned was, I don't get a lot. Go on, go yeah, so I used to make, that's the kind of music that me, I want to make. I don't know about you. So if you listen to my beats, them, I'm not really very good, but I think the slowest big song that I've done is Olulufe. I really like to dance. I don't know how to dance, but I really like to make people dance based on, they say creativity is born out of your subconscious. It's out of waiting you down already here, which you don't let. this thing. So I just really want people to dance this, and I wish I sabi do.
So you named Mohit, you guys started it. So what, this time it was a partnership?
Yes, yes.
50-50.
Yes, I told him to take 60, let me take 40. But he said,
why?
No.
Why did you want him to take 60?
That's how I am, so that you don't feel that I'm cheating you.
But he, said, he rejected, he said,
he said, no. How are you going to say that? 50-50. So yes. Then that way too, I also trusted him. Yeah. But that's me, really.
And we had, so this Don Jazzy persona, or the former Don Jazzy, not this Don Jazzy that we know now, you know, the one that used to talk, they whispered in your ear. Apparently it was his idea, was your idea?
It's everybody's idea. I think it was, let's just even give the idea what's his name? DJT.
Okay.
It was the thing that really made me to first think that the think of the fact that my name was Don Jazzy.
There was something there.
Yeah, it was made him. When we wanted to shoot the video for Tongolo, it was like, you know, your name is Don Jazzy, so you're going to be on the chair there and you sit like a Don, you know, we hold like a walking stick. And this is, so I think that was the first time I actually thought that the name was really, really
heavy.
Yeah, but after a while, I didn't really, really like it too, because it slowed me down.
I believe you, because seeing this Don Jazzy now on social media, I'm like, this, what was happening then?
I've met people that really think that I'm a drug baron.
So how hard was it to keep that up? That whole, you come out.
It wasn't really that hard, considering the fact that I'm also shy. So if I don't really know the people around me like that,
just quiet.
I lock up. I can't remember being on stage and seeing anybody. I don't used to see people that put on stage and they've seen everybody. I don't see anybody. I really want to just be at the back there and just be making music, focus on the music there. They see that people that are really called for this artist life, you know, go out there, you know. Ladies scream, do that. Everything sounds awkward to me. So I just come and I just say, ladies scream. I go laugh myself. This is funny to me. This is so that the people that know how to do it. It's not me. This is, I like to be in the studio, make music, make people around me laugh, have fun. Yeah.
So it was okay for the band to be the guy.
Yeah.
Because he had the energy.
Oh, that was very perfect. See, there are different reasons. Also, when you look at history, it's also good to study like history and things that have happened in relation in the music industry before you and stuff like that. Then you see that people used to have issues. Why? Because so person, you're not supposed to be in. You're not the person that's supposed to be in the fucking limelight. Why you now chucking head or wanting to take shine from the person? So in order not to give him that thought at all, self, it's okay. You're the artist, you're the front man. You take the shine that you need. It's fine.
No, but so I understand that. But like I said, seeing you now and what you are, social media and people who even meet you. Yes, you're still a shy in person. I definitely agree with that. Mm. But you have a personality.
Yeah.
With Mohit, you were not heard
at all.
You were hardly seen. There was almost no personality. It was just this show up, glasses, and disappear.
Thank you very much. Please, can you please permutate for me how that guy would have survived 8 years or 9 years after Mohit? Can you please explain to me?
Yeah. So how did you even do it for 8 years?
I did it for that 8 years.
Yeah.
It wasn't difficult. There's somebody in front. We are surviving. I don't have a problem with being behind as long as there's somebody in front. It's a body. It's a collect. We're together.
Yeah.
It's a common goal that we're driving at. I don't need to be in front if there's somebody in front that is surviving.
Yeah.
You understand? But then the moment it got to the point where I was like, okay, shit.
Now I'm carrying the load.
It looks like this ship is going to sink. Who's going to now carry the load? There's nobody that's going to be in front. They're just going to be like, that producer guy that used to whisper into the band's ears. They're just going. It keeps people forgetting. I mean, producers are not really that big like that. So let's call a spade a spade. The ones, before me, You see, can you please mention the ones that are still, okay, God bless you, so OJB before me. This is, but then I needed to do something and do it quick.
Yeah.
So I was like, I need to be heard, I need to be seen. And I was like, it's not time for whispering again.
So was the whispering phase hard?
It wasn't really hard like that, but wasn't hard.
So which is, I don't say the real.
They're both real, though.
Yeah. They're both real phases of the same person.
Now I just don't whisper to anybody's ear. There's nobody else that I whisper. With the space that you see somebody whispering before is void. I'm not whispering to anybody else. So that's why you say, I don't do interview, I don't do this thing. I don't. I actually do not. I don't. Once in the blue moon, that's where I go and do it. I don't go and be doing promo rounds. And this, it's not a matter of I run away. If they call, it's not like they don't ask me. Yeah. CNN, BBC, this one. I turn down.
Thank you very much for coming here.
I almost turned down this one, 30 minutes to this thing because I saw that clubhouse this time. I know that it's supposed to be on clubhouse because friends have asked me before to come on that clubhouse. I said, I don't want to do clubhouse. I saw that thing. I was like,
well, technically, Bounce was on clubhouse, not you.
I did not know.
That was for his hand spoiler, oh, Gary. Okay, so Mo Hits, it's now you and the band.
Yeah.
When did it become a thing of, okay, let's find other people to sign?
It was natural. They were always there. Someone like the Prince, my brother, he has always been there. K-Switch, the band's brother, he has always been there. Dr. Seed had featured in a song that we did during the JDCF 419 squad time. So he was close to the band. So he used to come around to come and see the band. And then when we came to Nigeria to shoot the video for Tongolo, he was the celebrity cameo in the video in Nigeria while we came in. We actually even left from his house in Mafoloko then. Yeah. So after a while, it just seemed that things were growing. Different people were asking, please, I can sing. Can you help me out? This one, blah, blah. So it wasn't, I won't say that we thought about it becoming this, this record label movement thing, but finding somebody that can sing, the moment that you can't miss one day and not be impressed, you understand? So we met Monico at some event that we went to in Unilag. That at the backstage, some group of guys came around and they were like, they wanted to dance for us. And we're like, okay, we didn't come with the dancers, our regular dancers that normally come with us to dance. And no problem. They show us what they got or whatever. So we played music at the back. All of us who were there, they started dancing. Okay, they could dance. After they finished dancing, we were like, okay, fine, nice. You guys could dance.
Thank you.
That's fine. No, you can come and join us and dance. We don't have a problem with that. So they were not like, that they could sing. They can sing too, but the dance, they won't dance. But today I said, wow, interesting. Okay, if you can sing for us. So they started singing each other's songs. And while they were singing each other's songs, they were backing each other up. You understand? So different of them. So at some point that they were singing, I thought they were actually like a group or something, but it was the next day that I found out that they were in a group. They were just backing each other up while they were singing each other's songs, but they knew their songs. Listen, but while all of them were performing this thing, I liked Wonders. They were actually very dope singers there, but that was just something about one day the way he communicated the melody that he wanted to pass.
Yeah.
Listen, it was
so did you get his number that day?
That same day.
All their numbers are just his own.
Just him.
Ah. So the other people did that, he said, you give me your number.
I created his number and I gave him my number to call me. So I saved his number and then he called the next day. I didn't pick, but then I called back. This is, yeah.
How did the other guys feel?
At the end of the day, you can't help everybody. I actually, funny enough, I liked two other guys there that night too, but it was the one that was more whatever in my face at the time.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, you should come through to the studio and let's try and work on something. So he came through to the studio and just didn't go back.
Something I wanted to ask, sorry, you know, we've talked about London and all of that and moving here and trying to sell the record label for 1 million.
Mm-hmm.
When did you realize we don't make up before all of these signings? You know, because Tongolo was big, but you're saying after that you were still trying to sell the label anyways.
Oh, the moment we did not sell the record label again, that's when we knew that we don't make up, because an endorsement deal came.
While you were still trying to sell?
Yeah, while we were still trying to sell. An endorsement deal came for the band Power Fist, which was 20 million.
Oh.
At that time, that was...
From 1 million to 20 million?
Yeah. So, we didn't need anybody to tell us.
So if you had sold it before then... Okay.
We didn't need anybody to tell us that, okay, this should... it looks like... most of the times when I'm on Twitter or Instagram and stuff like that, and I see the narrative or the way the industry or industry guys are positioned, the gatekeepers and things, it's like I see a lot of people are against labels.
Yes, very true.
I don't know why they're like that.
There's a lot that has happened that made people feel that way.
Don't generalize. You understand? Because we actually built this shit from nothing too. If you feel like Sony or Universal or Warner or any record label in the Western world, if you feel, I don't know what bias you have for them. We are pretty much an independent. Pretty much independent. We didn't grow. We didn't try to succeed. You understand? It's not like money fell from somewhere. We built it from scratch from the get go. So I don't know what the bias. I don't know what the bias is. I don't know that evil thing I used to follow record labels. Oh, record labels! I swear to God, that's used to do me like. I'm like, what should I do? What should I do? I don't do anything. See, my lawyers, they were tired of me. This is because he said, at some point, I used to put in my contract that summer,
there is summer,
whatever the case may be, when they get to the point that you don't tire, you no want to do again.
Please
feel free to carry your load and be going. It's not just nobody will kill you, nobody will disturb you. Like, if I carry you go court, are you kidding me? Who gave that time? I'll move on to another artist. I don't ask the card to them. Nobody has time. This thing. Summer, you don't want to work with me. I don't know why I want to be with you if you don't want to be with me. You don't want to be with me. Come on, go. Like, you know, we made music, we made money, we did business, and it was working at some point. At some point now, you feel like you're strong enough to go and do it on your own. Please. This is so. Then, but when the way the fans used to carry it, like, hey, no, it. You will not be with people, you will not tie them. He said, who did you tie? Who?
I bet who you tie?
Who they tie? Who? Nobody tie who? Please, by all means, come and be good. If you feel like I'm not, I believe I am valuable. If not be when are they produce? Oh, well, I see they produce now, still, whatever. I have the number one song in the country, God damn it. Fuck it. So, So I'm just saying, I believe Donati is in his prime. If I'm not valuable for writing and producing your music, now I will be valuable for your promo.
Yeah.
I don't need sleep now. Come on now. I mean, I'm Donati. I'm not hungry, but I didn't carry box for her to promote artist with just cop. Like, come on. I really, this is so. I believe I am valuable. So I'm serious. I am valuable. I like to be valuable. So I do my best with whatever numbers of followers that I have now, whatever goodwill that I have, or whatever, I do my best to use it and push the artist to the best that I can, to the point that if you feel like you don't want to work with me anymore, it's fine. You can leave, but my absence will be felt. Stephanie?
You think that's always happened? With everybody who's left?
To a certain level. I think I come with a lot of grace. I swear to God, in my head, I think I come with a lot of grace. I think I come with a lot of goodwill. No matter how your talent is amazing, it's great. But there's so much that talent can. People are talented. There's so much that talent can give you. Yeah. It is what it is.
Fair enough. We're going to get to the people living and all of that. So at the height of Mohits, how many artists did you have? Dibanj, The Prince,
Dr. Seed,
Ikechukwu, Wandeko, K-Switch?
K-Switch. You know all of them. You can't ask me.
When did it start disintegrating? Was it Dibanj leaving that was the first?
Don't say it like that.
Yeah.
We had a relationship.
Yeah.
And at the same time, we had the business relationship.
Yeah.
I don't know which one crept into which. But it got to a point where I wasn't comfortable with either.
Yeah. Before the Good Music deal, were things already bad at that point?
Yes.
What made it get there? Because I'm sure it wasn't one thing.
No, yes, definitely. It was a series of things. But then, who cares?
Money was still being made anyway.
Yeah, money was.
But you guys were talking?
Yes, we were talking. We were living in the same house.
But we were just not friends.
Friendship now became a little bit. We should see each other on CCTV. But then.
Why? So how did it get there?
It shall go there. Something happened. Either I they vex you they vex me. I don't understand.
I mean, if you've worked with someone for years, you've made money together, we see you guys, as a partnership, as a brotherhood, and you're not talking but living in the same house. How does it get that bad? Is what I want to know.
My brother, if you ask me, now who I go? But it does happen. We try to make it work, but relationships deteriorate. I don't know what it is. Maybe I'm snoring too loud from my room. I eat and I don't wash the plate. I'm just saying, none of this happened. But
So we're just petty things.
I mean, it can be just small things that there's no point for anybody to just come and sit down and just start saying, oh, this, without the internet of today turning it into
something else.
Yeah, turning it into something else that is not, especially when it's been 9 years. Begin with them born that and then they talk now.
Then enter secondary school.
Then they talk, then they know what the penis be. Yeah, there's no need for us to actually just even really be stressing it. It's not that. It's important, it's an important thing, but then there's no need for us to stress it anymore. Two people have moved on,
So if you guys were not good, why did you still go ahead with the Good Music thing?
Because it was good music now. Why did we go ahead with the Good Music team?
Knowing that you were not.
Yeah, we were not good, but it's not like we felt like it was the end. We felt like it was one of those. Okay, you're quarreling, but you'll be all right at some point. We've been living together for 8 years. So it's not the first time they were quarreling.
How long did you guys not talk for?
This not talk. It's not that. This not talk.
You say you're the same for CCTV. You're not talking.
This not talk. It's not like we know that we're not talking.
You were just not talking.
We were just talking. We just see each other. It's not like it's registered. People use the register. We're not talking now.
Look, I mean, in that 8 years, there must have been a point where, because you're living with somebody.
See. And to be honest, it's not like anybody, there's no fight. It's not fight. Nobody threw
blood. I know there was no fight. No. I mean, if it was a fight, they were for here. Nobody, it was obviously a gradual.
Yeah, it was a gradual process. It was just if to say na man and woman thing, they go say na falling out of love, or they just fell out. That kind of thing. If it was that kind of relationship,
marriage.
For the marriage, it was just a case of where, you know, some places where we used to see eye to eye, we don't see eye to eye in those kind
was
of
it, things. Was it business conversations? Was business affected? Is what I mean.
I would say a little bit of both, to the best of my knowledge.
Yes.
But then it might be that if you ask him, that it might be he will say something else. But like I said, whatever it is, 9 years after, it's not really matter.
Yeah. Did you want to do good music or did he make you do it?
I would say he made me do it. I would have wanted to. It's good. It's good music. Yeah.
So you would have done it anyways.
I did it.
Yeah. So you did it, and we were told.
What were you told?
By the Banj in an interview he did.
Okay.
I think around the time that sort of you were scared
of
taking a risk. You know, it's like a new environment. You were scared of, you know, this monster that is America.
Okay.
Is that a way to look at it? And you were comfortable being the king?
Being the king, like a Luka king.
If you put it that way.
I understand. You can put it that way. Yeah. But I would say that I was very calculative. I was very... I went to the market. I looked at the market, and from my own understanding, the market was not ripe enough. It was not ready at the time. This thing.
So it's 2013,
2012. It wasn't ready. I did a song on Watch the Throne that was stripped off, like the this when I did the song when this we did the song in the studio, it was full warrior. The lift off one, we're gonna take you to the moon. There was a go-go, there was this. So, by the time at the end of the day, the music came, it was stripped off and it was turned to what they felt like they were comfortable with. I knew that the market wasn't ready.
Yeah.
It's not.
So, you weren't intimidated or anything?
I don't know about intimidation. Talent passed talent, to be honest. This day, I'm not going to sit down here and be comparing lyrical talent with Burna Boy. Come on, yo, he's a lyricist. He knows how to do his thing. And I'm not going to say that my pen game is that great. But can he make beats like me? No, he can't. You understand? So if I'm in the room with a bunch of people that I feel like their pen game, how do I remember all this Kanye West and his people? There are plenty amazing Grammy winners in that place. It's not about being scared of them. It's about calling a spade, man. It's about seeing something and know that this is what it is. It's about looking at the markets that you want to sell the. You see, if you carry David now, carry a song, let's say, or Wizkid, one of his biggest songs. Two of them, or any of the three of them, and just carry it and just put it on Media Takeout, Shade Room. The music, nothing to do with the flying, nothing to do with the person, the flyness, the flying flyweight debts, money and stuff, just the music. You see, really, really small minded. Comments. Americans and people just come in there and just leave very, very stupid comments. Like, what are these ones singing? Are these, do these ones still have lights? Or are they still jumping on the trays? And there are people that are still really, really small-minded, yeah. even in this time. Not to talk of that time. Just expecting...
The sound was very new.
Yeah, it was very new. It never blew like that. This thing. So I knew that the time would come. But then I had other people that were in Nigeria. When the code was still here, the seed was still here, the prince was still here. I couldn't just jump and just stay in the America there, wasting money in hotels and flying privates and moving in proximity with where they are or around where they were. And while where we were making the money was suffering.
Yeah.
Like, it didn't make sense to me. Come on.
This skit life now that we now see with you. Was it a deliberate move?
Why are you calling it a move?
Because it's not the Don Jazzy we knew.
The Don Jazzy that you knew in the time that you knew Don Jazzy was there, social media. You don't know whether in that time maybe I would have still been whispering into the man's ears in the social media content way. But you never know.
When last were you in a relationship?
1 month ago.
You just broke up 1 month ago.
I don't know whether I've broken up.
What did you do?
Wait to see whether she's going to call me back. There's this girl. I like her a lot. I can't tell you her name. Whatever.
She's in the
whatever.
Industry?
No, she's not in the industry. She lives in the state. She's Nigerian. And then again, I don't really think she likes me that much. What exactly does she like?